So the idea is that we have a car under the city light, and it's and there is a sensor on it. We try to measure the illuminance, and if it's off, then we have to send an alert. So here is my rig, and I'm showing that I have different devices that you can imagine in a car. So we have the GPS unit, which is here Raspberry Pi Zero. And there is an IoTVT server on it, which is sharing the position to whoever wants to listen to it. So I have a client on the phone, which is displaying the position on the map. The phone is just to explain. So on the other side, I have on the box a very luminous sensor, brightness sensor. It's running on Raspberry Pi 2 and on the AGL automotive restoration. And I have also a relay to control the front light of the car. So when you put this together, you have what you need for this problem. So what I want to show that this green is a city light, my custom city light. And if I hide my sensor with this piece of black, then the front light are turning on, and in the end, there is a notification to the cloud telling that there is something happening now. So the first row with a little spot, we will see this, is illuminance in lumen, and then the position, latitude, and longitude. So we have three numbers, and I'm just sending an alert. I'm not collecting all the data every time I can, just here, there is probably a problem. So then, once the data is in this cloud, you can imagine a service to show this on the map. So if I show it again, yes. So this is an I2C sensor, and I will explain later how to deal with this. So there is two actions. One is to turn on the car front light and send a notification to the city or whoever can. And also, all the resources can be controlled by different devices. So here I have a smartwatch running Tizen operating system. And if I want to turn on or off my light or whatever, I can do this. I'm not telling this is something desirable, so I'm just saying that technically you can do it. So I will explain now in detail if you want to do it again, how can you do it. So first, let me introduce what is Open Connectivity Foundation. So this is a group that aims to provide all the software to provide connectivity between devices. And the first goal of this group is to provide a real world specification. We're not reinventing the wheel. There is already an existing solution, and we're just trying to put it together to get something useful and can be shipped in a product and address many use cases. So we are relying on the CoAP protocol, and we are also, data serialization is done using the CIBOR format. And the other goal of this group is to provide and sponsor the implementation of the specification. So there is a very close relationship between Open Connectivity Foundation and IoTVT, because standard. If it's in the standard, this means that they're doing it before. And in the other way, it's the same. So this is the specification, open standard, and open source implementation under Apache and Tool License. So if you want to create product, I will recommend you to join the group and to get certification on the product. This means if you are making a product supposed to do something, probably you can interact with other people who are supposed to go through this thing. And I will explain it. So let's get on the protocol side. So it's a RESTful design. You have some initiation server side and client side, and then there is a discovery mechanism. This means that any service, there is a server which is providing the services, and any client can discover the services and do some action about changing the state of a resource or get the value of it. So this is a back and forth communication. And some mechanism which is very interesting is observation feature. This means that if a resource is changing in real time, every subscriber will be aware and be notified. So you don't have to implement your own calling logic. It's under the system. So practically, you can run on a modern system with a CPU. Also, we are supporting low constraint devices. And there is another sub-project for very low constraint devices, so you can have a very wide range from microcontroller to computers or mobile phone. So today it's integrated in many systems. We have Python, Gemini, AGL, and any Yocto system, and we are making some progress to try to make it easier for everyone. So the core part is a C library using a protocol, and the footprint is about 100K, so it can fit into a microcontroller. What can I say on top of it? We have a C++ API, which is providing more object-oriented facilities. And as like this, we have all those services, and Simon will speak about how can we provide more services than just basic service. So let's get back to reality. So I'm not a JavaScript developer, but I wanted to explain it in JavaScript because it's quite a compact code and it gives you the idea of the logic. So if you're a C hardcore developer, you can do the same thing. So just using it via JavaScript. And because we have some bindings to Node.js. So this is a great contribution from Intel. And Node.js is quite interesting because there is a huge community and you have a lot of pre-module ready to be used. So you just need to install it using the package manager, and it will into your system. It's based on the C version of IoTBT. So if I get back to my problem, so first is about the sensor. So there is no black magic here. I'm just using I2C sensor, and there is somebody made a package to support it. So you just need to initialize it on Raspberry Pi, which is a I2C bus, and the its address, and there is just one function that is right, which is just getting back the parameter. Now we are talking about blindness, and we want to make something around this. Maybe instead of reinventing the wheel, OCF is proposing a lot of model to define things. So maybe you can have a look at what's inside this repository, and if the model you are talking about is not really done by that. In case of the illuminant sweep, somebody did this, and we have a normalized illuminance object called OIC, resource sensor illuminance, which is describing that illuminance is just a number. That's it. So we're just reusing these names. if you want to create yours, you can propose a new name. So that's back to the connectivity. We have this in Minos and we want to share it to whoever wants to be aware about this. So we are creating an IoT server, and using Node.js, we need to import a module, IoT node low level. We initialize it as a server, and we had some configuration flag to say that this device is observable by the users. So each time it is changing, we can just send a notification and everyone will be aware. So this is just a flag and a function. So if we are in JavaScript, there is an update event on the sensor, which is notifying the listeners. So the listeners is client side. So first we have to we have to discover the resource, and once it's found, then we can handle on it and try to work with it. So on my code, once I found the resource, if the resource is identified by this path, Ignance resource realize, this is just a sample, I can just starting watching for it, and on each update event, I will process it. So that's not simple. So first you have to find it, and then you have to listen to the update codecs. So the last part of this presentation is sending back the data to the cloud. So I'm using for this demonstration ArtiCloud, which is a cloud designed for IoT solution by Samsung. And to use it, yes, there is different approach, but I use the Node.js one, which is the base of this project. And I have to install a HTTP REST client, and then I can send the message. So first I have to declare my device on this cloud backend, and once I get some identification code, I can send data back to it. So in my case, the data is just Illuminant's value. I kept reusing the OCF model name because you have to declare it before, but you can do anything. So here is a overview about what we are doing. So in the yellow box, we have this Illuminant object, which is identified by a URI. One of its properties is a value under the Illuminant's property name. For the position, it's the same. And for the ArtiCloud, we are sending an object which is a composition of the two, the Illuminant and the actual position. So that's just the idea. And the basic rule is on the right. This means that if Illuminant is below some threshold, this means it's too dark, then we are just sending the message to the cloud. That's the idea. And we are doing this on each change of the illumination sensor. So I have a beep which is doing this each 10 seconds. I think, yeah, I show it. Now I think it's done for zero. Maybe I explained about ArtiCloud, but there is also another project in IoTVT called IoTVT Net Cloud.
Is to support a multi-user secure connection. So if you look at this architecture, this is actually what we have at this moment. the basic infrastructure for cloud. We have region cloud, which region cloud is a small cloud here, which is scattering basically everywhere. If we can do it around the world, that could be the case. And then all the scattering region cloud will connect to our global cloud. So the functionality in the region cloud, basically, we have, the main thing is the cloud interface server. So what it does is basically it accepts the connections from all IoT devices, and then receive all the notifications. Afterward, we send all the RESTful messages to connect the pipelines. So the main functionality, but actually the core part for this cloud interface is we actually based on 90 framework. And on the top, we added the co-op over TCP support. As Phil mentioned earlier, basically, IoT is heavily on co-op. In the global cloud, we have introduced a client server. This is the other to achieve the other goal. Basically, it's just a support user level authentication. So what happens is, if as a user, you use your smart device, your rich device, that we call rich device, to go to your third-party service provider, like Google or Facebook, get your get your token. And then you send your token to the telecom server through your cloud interface server to the account server. The account server gets this information, and then it will connect to your third-party provider like Facebook and Google again, get your user information. This user information will be stored in the account server. So basically, account server have your all as a user has all your user identity and information. Afterwards, so it will send the response back to your cloud, to the device. With the account server in place, basically we manage to provide interface for the third party authentication provider like Google, Facebook to extend their user identity to IoT cloud. And for thin cloud, concept for thin cloud is constrained devices with very limited resources and memories. We rely on the resource directory, the server in the middle, to do their for their cloud actions. So what that is the thin device basically publish their resource to resource directory, and the resource directory after resource directory got the resources from the devices, from then on, it will act on behalf of the devices to respond to any resource request. We also introduced the message queue server. This is basically, we actually kind of a multi-line PubSub. So we also have a PubSub functionalities. So it enables, we also basically you can do whatever you do with PubSub. You can create a topic. You can update your message, and then you can unsubscribe, or delete a topic. So basically, this is what we have now for cloud. So with the cloud in place, basically we really make the use cases, scenarios for IoT move to the next level. This service is another set of functions from IoT. So the basic goal for this one is to make the application developers' life easier. So we wrapped all the possible resources related functionalities, hide all the lower level complicated part of the base code, and then wrap them into C++ APIs. So what we have here, resource container. This resource container basically provide a way for non-OCF devices to integrate into OCF ecosystem. by providing a basically resource bundler. So the, you know, you do within the bundler, you do protocol mapping. So for example, if I have a, because in IoT we use a message queue over graph. So you can connect LTT device to MQTT device. You need to create a resource bundle between them to, you know, based on resource container template to make them work. And notification basically is, as the name said, really we are caching and monitoring the status, the features of the resource and send the updates to observers. Resource encapsulation is abstract layer on top of the base layer. So it's really just a resource, any resource related under layer of APIs, we actually wrap them up as provided in C++ API. And scene manager. The concept of scene here is a collection. So when you think like, I have in my house, every room has a light. So all the light, I put them together as a thing called a light thing. So if I'm going away for a business trip, what I do is, rather than send notification to every light, what I do is just send one notification to the thing. The scene manager will do the rest for you. And the last one is easy setup. So easy setup basically is, in IoT devices, they could have multiple devices which support different connectivity protocols. So with this easy setup, we actually provide two stages. One is onboarding, the other is provisioning. So if I give an example, we have a new speaker out of the box without UI. And the new speaker connect to your home access point. So what you have here is using your mobile phone. The mobile phone is already in your home network. So what you have here is the mobile phone will find the whatever access information of the speaker, either via Bluetooth or just scan the QR code, set up a temporary connection, and then it will then send the access point information to the speaker. Resource model we built here. This is the onboarding stage, which means you are on. But then after that, the mobile phone will push the access point, all the password or access point address to the speaker. Basically, Open Connectivity Foundation established a standard specification to address the interoperability issues in IoT. OCF sponsors open source project IoTVT to do the implementation of the specification. And then once the implementation is done, OCF will step in again to certify all the devices which has those implementations. And Phil has also worked you through IoTT node. It's really the bridge to bridging our IoTT native code to web service interface. And then you might also see the article cloud provide really good backend. And then we work through the native cloud services.
So yeah, I can show the demonstration again. So let me take it. Yeah, just a few. Yeah, okay. So the demonstration is about this I2C bright sensor, and if I change F cover this, the relay is turning on, so the message has been sent. So maybe I can either we can answer question, and I can also show you some extra stuff related to the project. So
yeah, let's do one or two questions, and then we have to move on.
Sure. So this is what I've done before, after previous president.
Okay, yeah.
Any question?
Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay.
Nice explanation.